So good morning, everybody, and welcome to the first of the second series of Dean Seminars on Chronic Disease. We have a stellar lineup this morning, and I just want to say a few words by way of introduction before we get started. We have a little bit of a different layout this year for these. We have, we've put out a schedule for you to pick up of the first series of these talks. The first four are going to, or we have four, I don't know that the first four, introduce some cutting edge science about chronic diseases, of which today's session on the dimensions is the first. We have one on telomeres and chronic disease. We have one on infection and cancer. We have one on the microbiome and chronic disease. And those will bring to us, as we have this morning, leading national experts in these fields to help us understand where the biology and the biological frontiers may be providing insights into prevention or at least reduction in prevalence of these diseases. And we have five other seminars on a variety of other key areas. One has to do with the idea of communicability and chronic disease and whether risk factors are not in fact as communicable in these connections as microbiological agents are. Connection with infectious diseases. We have one on the idea of vulnerability. The subtext there is, why isn't everybody sick? We have another on early determinants, one on aging, and one on gene-environment interactions. So we tried to put together a varied and interesting set of seminars for you. I hope you'll all mark your calendars for these well in advance so that we have as many of you here as possible. We also have a little bit of a different format this year. Instead of a formal second presentation, we've invited faculty experts to open the discussion following the visitors' talk. And my dream is that particularly the students will enter the discussion, offer your questions, be unembarrassed, tackle these great people with whatever it is that's on your mind. So please, don't be bashful. I'm sure our speakers will welcome your comments. So that having been said, let me just briefly introduce what's happening here today. As you know, dementia is a worldwide problem. In this country, it has been an increasing problem for some decades, connected with and appearing in parallel with aging of the population. There's some reason to think that the steady increase in the prevalence of dementias has leveled off and in fact may have sagged a little bit in recent years. And we'll hear something about that as this seminar progresses. There are a lot of kinds of dementia. We're focused especially perhaps today on Alzheimer's disease, the leading cause in this country. And there's been an enormous amount of research in recent years that has begun to really get at the neuronal level as well as population level associations with the risk of Alzheimer's disease. And we've put together for you from thanks to our speakers four marvelous papers which will be online, which are online already, and will be with the tape of today's session really are enormously illuminating and very exciting. One of them is an elegant description for current knowledge of the epidemiology of Alzheimer's disease. Another describes the results of a genome-wide association study of late-onset Alzheimer's disease in African Americans, and the identification of what appears to be an associated gene. A third describes direct experimental demonstration of the toxicity at the synapse level of treated extracts of the brains of patients who've died of Alzheimer's disease. And a fourth, it's a fascinating study of the apparent protective effects of environmental novelty and enrichment and of the use of beta-adrenergic agonists. So progress is being made at a number of levels. This is an exciting frontier, and we're very fortunate to have with us today two of the world's experts in this area, both of whom, as it happens, are Columbia alumni. Dr. Dennis Selko is our seminarist, and he is the Vincent and Stella Coates Professor of Neurological Diseases at the Harvard Medical School and senior neurologist at Brigham and Women's Hospital. He's a Columbia Baccalaureate alumnus, holds his MD from the University of Virginia, trained in neurology and neuroscience at Harvard and at the National Institute of Neurologic Diseases and Stroke. He has been a prolific contributor to the literature on the molecular basis of neuronal diseases, especially Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. So he is a member of the National Advisory Committee on Aging at the NIH and the Scientific Advisory Board of the Alzheimer's Research Forum. Numerous awards, as you'd expect. He's a member of the Institute of Medicine, has received the Lifetime Achievement Award of the Alzheimer's Association, and many others. Our faculty speaker today, who will open the discussion, is Dr. Richard Mayhew, who is a professor of neurology, psychiatry, and epidemiology, and chair of the Department of Neurology here at Columbia, director of the Gertrude H. Sergievsky Center, and co-director of the Taub Institute for Research on Alzheimer's Disease and the Aging Brain, all here at Columbia. He has led the Washington Heights Inwood Community Aging Project for some 25 years. Dr. Mayhew received his medical degree from the Oklahoma School of Health Sciences, trained at the Boston City Hospital, and here at Columbia Presbyterian. He's an alumnus of this School of Public Health in epidemiology. He, too, has been a prolific contributor to the literature on Alzheimer's and other degenerative diseases, and he, too, has been honored very widely and is a member of the Institute of Medicine. He's received the Columbia Dean's Distinguished Clinical Scientist Award and the Rita Hayworth Award of the Alzheimer's Association. So we've got the cream of the cream here to tell us about Alzheimer's disease, and we're going to open with Dr. Selko.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good afternoon. Can you hear me all right? Let's see some hands in the back of the room that it sounds fairly normal for my somewhat gravelly voice. Great to be with you, and sincere thanks to Jerry and to Linda and their colleagues for inviting me to what I think is a very smart way to organize the study of chronic disease and its prevention at the School of Public Health. I like this approach because compared to so many academic visits where you have such a short time to talk to faculty and to students, this looks like it's going to be a much more gentle period of course of discussion over the time of the next hour and a half or 2 hours or so. I'm going to speak to you about a topic that I care immensely about, as does Richard, my good friend for many years and a collaborator on some things. And it seems a little bit noisy. Does the microphone seem noisy or is it fine now? Yeah. It's a little raspy. It might just be my voice, but I don't know if this other microphone would work better. You can ask the AV people. And I'm really pitching this to the students at the Mailman School of Public Health because I really want to not just engage my colleagues. There are several of them who know all this by heart, and some of them know it better than I do, and we can debate esoteric nuances ourselves, but I'm really going to try to present the tremendous problem of Alzheimer's disease, this chronic disorder, to you from the clinical and the pathological and the molecular standpoint. Now, Jerry and I discussed that a number of you are not molecular biologists, and so I want to make clear that while we understand a few details of the molecular pathogenesis, there's an enormous amount, much more really, that we don't understand. But I'm going to explain it to you, and as would be appropriate for someone you invite to, from out of town as a visiting fireman, I'll present it from my perspective. There are many other perspectives, and I think we'll get into that in the discussion. So you can see my title, and I should tell you that I've had commercial connections in that I was the principal founding scientist of a little company called Athena Neurosciences that no longer exists, but has metamorphosed into a company we now call Prothena, a play on words on purpose. And Prothena is a company that I'm a director of. But what I'm going to tell you today really has very little or nothing to do with that. And the work that I'll display is happening in my academic lab in Boston and not related to that company's interests. So one of the things that one has to come to grips with is how one conceptualizes any chronic process in human or animal biology. How does one think about the process? And the way that I've thought about it for a long time is that Alzheimer's disease, in essence, is a synaptic failure. It is an abnormality of synaptic biology, and we've been struggling for the last 30 years, or really for the last 100 years since Alzheimer described the disorder, to understand why selected synapses give up the ghost, so to speak. And I like this cartoon that will show you a little bit about how synaptic failure is envisioned in a theoretical framework. So we know that the electrochemical signal that goes from one axon onto a hero cell body, so an axon somatic synapse, that can go cold over time, that eventually the synapse ceases to release its neurotransmitter and the synapse dies out completely. And we would like to know over time how it is that occurs and why it occurs to certain synapses and not others. So the cartoon really illustrates what I think happens in my patients' brains. And this is how Richard and I and Larry and many others, Scott, who are in the audience, see this in the clinic. We ask patients to draw clocks, and we learn that they're not able to do that properly. So if you ask someone to put in the hands at 4:45, they make a good attempt at this and put it in at 4:45, it seems like that, to them. And then other patients, if you ask them to draw the face of a clock, will draw the face of a clock or face on a clock. So they take me quite literally. Yeah. Okay. And they do it quite literally, and when this lady was told, well, you know, that's actually what I said, but not really what I meant, so you have to read my mind, I'm the doctor, you're the patient, I didn't put it quite like that, then she drew a very nice clock that said 4:45, and this patient was more advanced, he's a four different patients, and really had a very disorganized clock, and this is one small example of what we do in the clinic. We try to decide what is the level of synaptic deficiency, what things can be done, what things can't be done, what neural systems might be involved, what are the other ancillary symptoms besides cognitive dysfunction that occur. Now, in the year 2014, we still summarize the disease in these kinds of broad statements, that it's the most common cause of dementia, at least in developed nations. It affects a large number of people. We don't know the exact numbers. It occurs in Americans of African, Asian, and European backgrounds at relatively similar prevalences, and Richard's work has made that clear. If one focuses on underserved communities that do not have as much knowledge about their Alzheimer's process, then one learns that obviously there's a ubiquitous disease and we need to pay attention to this in all members of society. It accounts for a lot of expenditure. This is a rough estimate from the Society for Neuroscience. And because there's no FDA-approved disease-modifying treatment, this cost is steadily climbing, and we need to get to one. Some of the current concepts of the disorder, again, for people who do not work in the field, and many of you don't, is that the term senile dementia is what the lay public has sometimes called senility. It is progressive mental failure, arbitrarily after age 65. We used to call Alzheimer's a pre-senile dementia occurring before age 65. Now we recognize that there really isn't a bimodal age distribution, but a continuous accrual of cases over the lifespan. The earliest case, perhaps, that I've been told about was a young lady at age 18 who had a presenilin mutation and developed what turned out to be bona fide Alzheimer's disease. So it goes gradually up with age. That's extremely rare, of course, and most cases occur after age 70 and continue into the 80, 90, and beyond. So we use the term senile dementia for after 65, but it's entirely arbitrary and not biologically based. It's based on the concepts of the Social Security Administration and the notion that we retire at 65, which I have not done. Alzheimer's is the most common of more than 20 causes, maybe more, many more than that, accounting for roughly two-thirds of dementia cases in the U.S. And it begins insidiously, usually with decreased memory and disorientation, progresses slowly over 5 to 20 years, and is fatal, shortening life expectancy by 1 to 2/3. People are often surprised at that. Doesn't make the heart stop beating, but it does cause so much debilitation that patients die of otherwise surmountable reasons. So if we get into the phenotype of the disease, what Alzheimer described and what many people have contributed to over the last 100 years, these are the defining characteristics. We still tend to diagnose it with the lesions that Alzheimer called attention to, amyloid plaques and neurofibrillary tangles. But we know that beyond that, there is a very profound inflammatory process that involves microglia and astrocytes in the brain, a selective loss of neurons, a synaptic loss that's much greater in some regions than others. And we say synaptic loss and single it out because neuronal degeneration is too broad. It isn't just a matter of whole neurons dying, but pruning back of certain synapses. And the attack may be on the synapses relatively early, although microglial cells are cells able to respond quickly to insults, and so they may be implicated even earlier yet. And the multiple neurotransmitter deficits that accrue in Alzheimer's disease make it different than Parkinson's or many other disorders that are more focused on one transmitter system. Acetylcholine, the first abnormality discovered by Peter Davies and others in the neuropharmacology field, is addressed by acetylcholinesterase inhibitors clinically. But they don't really slow down the fundamental molecular process. So those of you who are not interested or focused on molecular and cell biology and have backgrounds in the social and behavioral disciplines, I'm going to bore you a little bit or make you nervous or maybe excite you, depending on how open you are to different ideas and concepts. So talking with Linda today, I've learned a lot about the public health implications of the human brain aging process, or aging in general, and I need to connect to people who do things different than I do. This is the kind of stuff that I like to do, that Richard does and Scott does and others in the room here, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about how I think the Alzheimer process unfolds. So in 1992, my lab, in the person of Michael Schlossmacher and Christian Haass, discovered that there was an orderly processing of the amyloid precursor protein. Steve Youngkin did similar work at the same time. And we learned that there was a cleavage of a single transmembrane protein we call APP. That's what you see here in red. The amyloid beta protein that makes up the plaques of Alzheimer's that I'll define for you in a moment was partly embedded in the transmembrane region of this amyloid precursor protein. So this would be a canonical cell wall, a neuron or a myocyte. Many other cells express APP at the cell surface and internally, and we learned that there was a processing event that was nicknamed beta secretase in the field that released the large ectodomain of APP, and then there was a second processing event that was very curious by a activity called gamma secretase. There was a beta secretase cleavage and a gamma secretase cleavage that released a part of APP that the Alzheimerologist in the world called amyloid beta protein, because George Glenner first defined it and called it such. So this is really all normal biology. All of us do this throughout life. You're doing it right now. And the question is, just like controlling cholesterol homeostasis adequately so you don't get a coronary event, can we control this process so it doesn't contribute to Alzheimer's, if indeed it is an important player, which I believe it is. The amyloid beta peptide that's produced normally, and this second cleavage is a very bizarre intramembrane proteolysis in the wall of the cell, in the lipid bilayer, that monomer can eventually find a mate, another monomer. This is probably energetically not favored, but the amount of A-beta in the normal brain during development in utero, which already is made, and our paper we showed it from fetal human neurons, is very low. But A-beta in some forms, especially the 42 amino acid form, A-beta 42, can make dimers and trimers and tetramers and dodecamers and larger oligomers. So we refer to those as oligomers or fumers, and those form fibrils, first protofibrils and then fibrils in the brain that you can see, as I often did in the days I was doing electron microscopy, as amyloid fibrils. And those form the amyloid plaques that Alzheimer first called attention to. This is an image from the amygdala of a patient I followed during life, and two spherical deposits of the amyloid beta protein, this material, but now in fibrillar form, in amyloid plaque form, surrounded by dystrophic axons and dendrites. These would be neuritic plaques. Adjacent are neurofibrillary tangles, an abnormality that I worked on after I learned a little bit about cytoskeletal biochemistry in Mike Shalansky's lab, and with Ken Kosick and others decided to focus on the composition of these tangles. And we, together with three or four other labs, defined those tangles as being composed of a protein called tau, a normal protein. So these lesions that Alzheimer called attention to have been the starting point for a lot of science. And it's been debated for decades whether they are really an epiphenomenon or a fellow traveler with the disease or are somehow etiologic. And my opinion, and I think the opinion of many others, are that these lesions are and can be etiologic, can trigger the process. Now, in the modern day, we don't have to wait until my patient dies. The slide I showed you was from a 69-year-old stockbroker from Dedham, Massachusetts, who died after about 10 years of disease. His mother had had early-onset Alzheimer's. But we can look with the wonders of positron emission tomography at a ligand that binds to amyloid fibrils. This is the ligand called Pittsburgh Compound B that Chuck Mathis and Bill Klunk came up with. And in a very exciting paper in 2004, they published that you could distinguish an age-matched control from an Alzheimer's subject by the binding and then the pseudocolored image of a PET scan of A-beta amyloid fibrils being bound by this Pittsburgh compound B, which is a derivative of thioflavin, a dye that was used for many decades in pathology. And the distinction here is perhaps a little bit more clear to the uninitiated, to the non-imaging expert, than even measuring glucose metabolism and fluorodeoxyglucose PET scanning, where there is a difference for sure, but it's a little bit less obvious, because here you're actually measuring a classical pathological component. So that means we can scan all of you, and that's what is being done now increasingly as we move to prevention, which is the touchstone of this seminar series. How do we prevent this process? We can image you now, we're not recommending everyone do it, to find out if you are on your trajectory to at least Alzheimer's pathology, if not Alzheimer's disease. So from what I've told you so far, it was clear really from Glenner's pioneering work and from concepts that a number of people, Steve Youngkin, myself, John Hardy, and others brought forward, that you could conceptualize Alzheimer's as a syndrome that arose from an imbalance between the production and clearance of A-beta, and especially A-beta 42. And that could lead to gradual accumulation in brain regions serving memory and cognition. And before the first genetics was done in the 1990-1992 frame, those of us interested in this biochemical process had hypothesized that genetics would show
that this genetic deficiencies or abnormalities can drive this amyloidogenic process. And environmental alterations play a role too, and we can debate those when we have time to dialogue. So I like to show the slide that of Arthur Schopenhauer's words from early 19th century Germany. As a philosopher, he made the obvious observation that all truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. And third, it is accepted as being self-evident. And in point of fact, that's true of many things we know in intellectual life. And in the case of the amyloid or A-beta hypothesis, we haven't reached the third stage yet. There's still plenty of debate, and I'll touch on why there is debate. But many of us also believe that it's ultimately going to feel like it's obvious, like it wasn't a thunderclap, like it made a lot of sense, even though it was resisted and is still, to some extent, for quite a while. Now, the validation of the concept that A-beta buildup is a sort of sine qua non and pathogenic feature of the disease came from genetics. But it preceded genetics. I think it's important to say that in contrast to Huntington's disease, for example, where one couldn't imagine how the Huntington gene did its dirty work until one cloned that gene, found its protein, and learned a little bit more about it, that it had, for example, polyglutamine repeats in it. You could start studying it. Here, the biochemical pathology of finding tau in tangles, A-beta in plaques, preceded that and then helped direct genetics to chromosome 21, where the APP gene is encoded. Now, we can jump ahead, and we know that there are at least four principal genes that are widely confirmed, and many other genes that contribute to the etiology of Alzheimer's disease. And Richard and I were just talking about the exciting new work that he's done, that he's followed over years, and now is bringing to a further conclusion about other genes that are not on this list, but will become and should be. The point here is that for the first four genes discovered, different mechanisms are involved, and the arrows all point up if you ask the question, how do these genetic alterations relate to the beta amyloid phenotype in the brain? We did a lot of the work in cell culture, as did Steve Youngkin's lab in the 1990s, and it's pretty well understood now that even the APOE4 polymorphism that is the most important genetic risk factor for Alzheimer's disease and is a very powerful one, has to do with the steady state level or density of A-beta plaques. Notice that I don't speak about production, but rather in the steady state level or density of plaques. Let me show you how one of these mutations work that we've worked on for a long time. That is a mutation in presenilin 1 or presenilin 2. And this is a diagram of every single amino acid in the presenilin 1 or 2 molecule. Happens to be presenilin 1, PS2 is a homolog. And in 1999, Mike Wolff and Weiming Sha, working in my lab, made the discovery that presenilin had two and only two aspartate residues by the single letter amino acid code, those are Ds, that flanked a region in which there could be a cleavage of presenilin to create a heterodimer, two parts of presenilin that stay together. So we hypothesized, based on a number of circumstantial bits of evidence, that these two aspartates were the long-sought element called gamma secretase, the second of the two enzymes or proteases that clip APP to release A-beta. This was unpopular, as so many new ideas are, but eventually was pretty much proven. And so we mutated one or the other of these and showed that if you mutated one of these aspartates, you couldn't make A-beta anymore if you were a mouse or a cell. If you mutated these in humans, you wouldn't survive because these particular aspartates that are circled in red are necessary for life in all metazoans and all multicellular organisms, and I'll tell you why in a moment. So the concept that came from this idea that presenilin was the long-sought active site of gamma secretase, and it does cleave substrates by itself, gave rise to a diagram like this, where presenilin is in purple, and the two aspartates are shown here as Ds within the membrane, within the plasma membrane of a neuron. And a protein called Notch and a protein called amyloid precursor protein and about 100 or more other substrates can be cleaved by this process that Brown and Goldstein of cholesterol homeostasis fame have called regulated intramembrane proteolysis, or RIP. And they base that in part on their own work on Site 2 protease and cholesterol homeostasis, and the work that we and others did on presenilin being an intramembrane aspartyl protease. So Notch is very important in cell fate determination throughout life. And when I look at this cartoon, which is a simplification of what does in fact happen in all of our brains, I assume that this machine was conserved, that is presenilin, endoproteolysis, and cleavage, to allow Notch to signal in the nucleus for cell fate determination. And the reaction on the right is almost identical to that. There are some nuances that are different, but that doesn't matter as much in biology. So if you conserve the presenilin cleavage of Notch to allow multicellular organisms to evolve and live, and indeed Ivor Greenwald at this university, at this medical school, showed in basic research that the cleavage of presenilin cleaving Notch was necessary for cell fate determination. If you don't let that happen, you don't have life, basically. In the case of APP, this is far less important in everyday cell biology. What I've just told you is a little bit about how A-beta is made, and the rest of what I'm going to talk about is how it does its dirty work. So in my opinion, the production of A-beta and the degradation of A-beta are very important topics, and trying to keep it in a monomeric state, less oligomeric, is also very important. So I'll focus now on some of the data we've generated over the last few years on its aggregation state in the human brain. The work I'm going to show you now is one of the papers that Jerry referred to, work done by an MD PhD student working in my lab and in part with Bernardo Sabatini at HMS Neurobiology. And what he did, what Ganesh did, was to isolate simple saline extracts from Alzheimer and control brains of people in their 70s, people who died, including one or two patients of my own who died, and we isolated amyloid beta monomers and dimers and larger oligomers and displayed them on a gel, on an electrophoretic gel with Western blotting. And what we showed, and this is all a simplification now, is that these A-beta monomer dimer rich extracts from an Alzheimer brain compared to a normal brain, and I said earlier that A-beta is made normally, but the amount here is so small that you cannot detect it at this level of exposure of the Western blot. Those fractions could be floated onto a healthy hippocampal slice of a wild-type rodent, like a rat or a mouse, or as we did initially, injected into a healthy rat brain. And we could see that fraction 4 here, that's rich in Alzheimer A-beta extract, could impair long-term potentiation, something that here at Columbia you probably don't need to be lectured about, something that is a remarkable electrophysiological correlate of learning and memory that Kandel and many others have helped to explicate at the molecular level. So long-term potentiation is a reasonable surrogate for aspects of memory and learning, and you want to have the trace shown in blue, which is when you take a sample control 1 and float it on a healthy hippocampal slice, you induce a long-term synaptic potentiation. Not so when you have the extract that's rich in the amyloid beta protein oligomers. However, that doesn't tell you what it was that did it. This experiment that Ganesh does, if you look at this little Western blot, you can immunodeplete the A-beta from this extract. Lane 2 showed that it's gone, and then take the same extract from an Alzheimer patient's brain and float it onto the hippocampal slice, and now you're in the blue zone. You have a normal long-term potentiation in this slice physiology, or you can do the whole thing in vivo as we did. And we also learned in this work, in the work of Xiamen Li, that you can induce synaptic depression. So here in red is something that's bad, and that is using a low-frequency stimulus in the hippocampus, you can induce a long-term depression of a certain synaptic circuit. And in this case, we show that the Alzheimer A-beta-rich material can facilitate long-term depression, whereas the control brain extract does not allow the maintenance of long-term depression in this particular electrophysiological paradigm. Now, that's interesting. that has to do with the study of electrophysiology in vivo or in vitro. But what about the cardinal symptom of an Alzheimer's syndrome, which is forgetfulness? And so we can't ask our mice and rats directly to retrieve word lists, but we can teach them tasks. And in a typical fear avoidance paradigm, you can condition a healthy adult wild-type rat to go into a open, dark chamber that it might prefer compared to the crowded, well-lit chamber. You then give it a single shock to its foot. It scampers back. And if you do this exact experiment with a cannula that's not shown here in the rat's brain, and this is what we did, you could infuse the material from one of my patients' brains into the animal's cerebral ventricles and learn what it does to the ability for the rat to remember that when it next goes into this box, it should avoid going into the place where the shock was administered. And what we find, and I'm not showing the data here, is that if you take extracts from a 78-year-old woman who did not have Alzheimer's disease and who has very little or no A-beta dimers, trimers, oligomers of various sorts, or amyloid plaques, then the rat remembers when it gets back in that cage 24 hours after being trained, and it doesn't go right away into that. After a while, it will explore. However, if you put in a 78-year-old woman's extract who did have Alzheimer's and is rich in oligomers, then time and again, the rat will not remember that. But if you immunodeplete those oligomers, or if you inject just monomers from the woman's brain, then the rat will remember that. We like to think of this as sort of a type of Koch's postulates, taking what we think is a pathogenic agent from a host and putting it into an innocent animal that's not diseased and seeing if we can replicate some of the abnormalities in the animal. Now, what's very interesting in Ganesha's work is that the amyloid plaques that were abundant in all of these Alzheimer brains look like this by a method that I actually developed when I was doing all my own experiments after leaving Mike Schlansky's lab up in Boston. And that is, you can extract amyloid plaque cores and purify them by fluorescence-activated cell sorting and other methods. And you can wash the purified cores sequentially in a detergent SDS and then eventually change to just tris-buffered saline or PBS. And you can wash away any residual monomers and dimers and higher oligomers that are associated with these plaques from one of my patients' brains. And when you then look at them under the light microscope, they look very, quote, clean, unquote. And when you take those and do that same LTP experiment, as shown in the upper right here, you get in red what the plaque cores do to the long-term potentiation. They leave it intact. And just as a blue tracing is a core prep from a non-Alzheimer's subject, which really doesn't make sense. We call it a core prep, but it's the same procedure done on a control brain that doesn't have amyloid plaques. But when Ganesh first solubilized the amyloid plaque cores in formic acid and neutralized the formic acid and then put plaque-equivalent amounts to this experiment on fresh hippocampal slices of wild-type mice, then you got what you got in red, suggesting that the plaques contain a soluble material that is detrimental to synaptic plasticity. Now, we've worked out some of the mechanisms, but by no means all, and we have our favorite theories about how this goes awry. And those of you who are neurobiologists in the audience can debate those later with me. And we think that the process of inducing a long-term synaptic depression, which involves a number of complex signaling cascades, some of which have been worked out by neurobiologists, that that is altered and heightened and facilitated by the presence of extracellular A-beta oligomers, these doublets and triplets that are in the extracellular space between the pre- and postsynaptic elements. And the little yellow dots, or blue dots rather, are glutamate, the key excitatory neurotransmitter. Our data suggests to us that soluble A-beta oligomers at picomolar quantities interfere with glutamate uptake at the synapse and block certain glutamate transporters. That elevates extracellular glutamate, that has so-called extrasynaptic spillover, that activates NR2B receptors and puts you down a long-term synaptic depression pathway. And we think that that is one of the reasons why people begin to forget how to draw a clock in the clinic. Now, I want to connect the two major lesions that Alzheimer described, the plaques and the tangles. And here I'm going to tell you a little bit about how Ming Jin in my lab took extracts from human brain again and tried to show that they induced some of the changes we could see in Alzheimer's. To do this, he used biochemistry to separate separate soluble A-beta oligomers, both the monomers and the dimers and higher oligomers. On a Western blot, they all are reduced by denaturation to dimers and some trimers, which you can see here in the starting material. But the monomers and the dimers can be separated. And the monomers are made by you and I throughout life. And so they are not a physiologically active form in terms of toxicity, but the dimers are. So when he took these two fractions, or these four fractions, fractions 8 and 9, 10 and 11, and floated them on entirely healthy neurons, cultured like all the labs around here do, from day 18 or 20, from rat embryos and then held to day 18 or 20, he could show that on the right panel, you could get a degeneration or dystrophy of the neurites and dendrites of these healthy neurons, whereas the monomers from the same patient's brain fractionation does not do that. And of course, control brain material doesn't do it either compared to vehicle alone. This is stained here with an anti-tau or anti-tubulin antibody, and this was a very robust phenomenon. And you can see here highlighted the effect of these soluble A-beta dimers and other oligomers from an Alzheimer patient's brain on the healthy neuronal cytoskeleton. Now, what about the tau protein, which is the subunit of the neurofibrillary tangles that Alzheimer described? Indeed, we can see if we highlight here the fact that certain epitopes of the tau protein, marked by certain antibodies, can become hyperphosphorylated. They have increased moles of phosphate per mole of tau. And then if you immunodeplete the A-beta oligomers from the preparation, you see what's happening here in lane 6, that you correct this elevation of tau. So in the cultured neurons, they respond to the application of soluble oligomers from our patients' brains by hyperphosphorylating tau at certain places where it's known to be abnormal in Alzheimer's brain. And what's very interesting is if you knock out the tau gene, as molecular genetics allows you to do, then here you no longer see tau staining in these neurons, and now you prevent the abnormal neuritic architecture that occurs with antitubulin staining. So the absence of tau in a neuron seems to prevent the neuron from responding to what I feel is the toxicity of amyloid beta oligomers. What's very interesting in this paradigm is if you take these same neurons that are only 10 days in vitro, not 20 days in vitro, none of this happens. So there's a tremendous control there. We're not dealing with non-specific biochemical effects, but rather with something that has specificity. And Ming Jin in the lab figured out that one of the key factors that allows a 20-day-old neuron in culture to succumb to the patient's oligomer preps, but not the 10-day, is a autophosphorylation event on GSK3-beta, one of the kinases that phosphorylates that. It doesn't happen until later on in culture. It has to occur in a way that disinhibits GSK3-beta and then allows, apparently, this response of neurons. Then we'll say one more thing about this, and that is you can float the oligomers of a patient's brain onto the healthy neurons together with an antibody, here 3D6, to the amino-terminus, and you can neutralize that. So you just put the antibody on with the oligomers, you don't get the neuritic dystrophy or the tau hyperphosphorylation. But another antibody to A-beta shown on the far right, C-terminal antibody, doesn't do that. So let me summarize what that data tells us, that soluble A-beta oligomers isolated from the brains of typical AD patients impair memory upon injection into healthy adult rats. Soluble oligomers can inhibit long-term potentiation, facilitate synapse depression, what we call LTD, and induce synapse loss in the hippocampus. The insoluble amyloid cores, at least as we isolate them from a postmortem brain, are largely inactive, but they do contain abundant A-beta oligomers that are toxic to synapses upon release from the cores. Soluble A-beta oligomers induce abnormal tau phosphorylation and profound neurite injury, but not if the tau protein is first deleted from the neurite. So there's molecular specificity. and certain antibodies to A-beta, particularly to the N-terminus and mid-region, can bind and neutralize the effects of these oligomers. Now, the last bit of data that I'll flash by you, and then I'll make some conclusions about where this is going in the clinic and in society, is to tell you about the concept of use it or lose it. So we've been laboring mightily in the Alzheimer's field for the better part of 3 decades to try to get to therapeutics, and we haven't gotten there yet. We have not yet found something that can be approved as a drug or molecule that you can take if you come to the clinic here. So another way of approaching the problem is to learn what behavioral modifications might stave off the Alzheimer process. And here, Xiamin Li and Ming Jin, in a paper published last year that you folks were given a copy of, used environmental novelty. So what I mean by that is when it can expose healthy young mice, again, wild-type mice, we tend to shy away from overexpressing APP transgenic models, as in much of our work that we do on synuclein or APP, we try to use just the endogenous wild-type complement. And if you expose these young mice for 4 weeks, or if they get older, you have to do it for 8 weeks or 12 weeks, which is interesting. But when they're young, you can do it for 4 weeks to a complex novel environment that I'm going to show you how much the mice enjoy. So on the right are the standard housing at Columbia University, and on the left is how we keep them at Harvard Medical School. And it disappoints me greatly to come to my friends and colleagues here and not see you guys get the idea here. I've shown this at many meetings, and you're still housing your mice the way they were on the right. The mice that go to Disney World here, basically healthy young mice, and they can be middle-aged mice, and we've done this now in old mice, 12 to 15 months old, which is pretty old for a mouse. They can enjoy new toys gotten from Petco and changed every 8 hours or so. They do this during the daytime. Might be smarter to do it at nighttime when mice are even more active because we're screwing up their nocturnal rhythms. But nonetheless, we find some striking effects of this kind of process. And this is, of course, the phenomenon of environmental enrichment that neurobiologists have studied for the better part of 2 decades. And we found, as others before us, that this will increase, if you look at the graph, the numbers of the size and the synaptic complexity of dendrites, not the numbers of dendrites per numbers of spines per dendritic length, but certainly the dendritic spine area and many other neurobiological correlates that benefit that the mice benefit from. Now, that also leads to something that was predictable, that there is a dramatic enhancement of long-term potentiation, this correlate of learning and memory, which you see here in red right there. And compared to standard housing mice that are littermate mice kept in another cage, we don't let them be next to each other because it's too sad for the standard housing mice to watch what's going on in Disney World. So we put them in a separate room, which is only, I think that was the ethical committee in our hospital that said we had to do that. And what we find is that this enhancement of synaptic plasticity that understandably accrues from a positive exposure to novelty can prevent the impairment from soluble A-beta oligomers. So for example, in the Western blot here, you see our separation of monomers from dimers, the dimers on the left, and larger oligomers. And you can see that in pink, this is the way that a standard housing mouse would respond to this fraction here. And in red is how an environmentally enriched exposed mouse would respond. That is, it's no different than a standard housing mouse that wasn't exposed to the badness of A-beta oligomers. So we can correct that abnormality. We figured out over time some of the signaling pathways involved in this. And you can see the tall bar here on the graph that, in particular, beta 2 adrenergic receptors, and you can see the Western blot right up here, the beta 2 adrenergic receptor, but not beta 1, DR1, DR2, 5-HT1, 5-HT2, muscarinic acetylcholine receptors 1 and 2, et cetera, all the other neurotransmitter receptors were not noticeably significantly impacted by this exposure to the environmental enrichment in the hippocampus of the mouse brain and synaptosome. So you can see the quantification of that on the right. So that gave us a clue that the beta 2 adrenergic receptor pathway was involved, and we decided to do sort of an exciting experiment from the point of view of a mouse biologist. We treated wild-type healthy mice that are living in the bad environment, the standard housing cage, with isoproterenol, a beta receptor agonist. And we did that for in the drinking water for 4 weeks, or if they were older, for 8 weeks. And we found that that had a quite nice effect compared to giving them water alone. So you see the standard housing mice now who had been treated with isoproterenol, and in red, they resist the negative effects of a dimeric preparation of A-beta. We also looked at exercise versus novelty. So should you guys go to the gym this afternoon, or should you read your latest papers, or better yet, my latest papers? And the answer is you should read my papers, and even better than that, read Richard's papers, which he's just writing up as we speak now with some very exciting new data. It turns out that in our artificial circumstances, novelty trumped exercise. And we did a little bit better with novelty, but obviously our best paradigm is to do both and to read while you run. Now, is it true then that you can use it or lose it? So we believe that exposing healthy wild-type mice to a novel environment protects or produces several benefits for hippocampal structure and function. Those benefits, which were predictable, make the EE mice substantially resistant to the acute synaptic toxicity of soluble beta oligomers isolated from our patient's cortex. Among numerous signaling cascades, and there must be many, augmented by E, but we've done some time course analysis, and we think that this is true early on, a beta-2 adrenergic receptor pathway shows more enhancement than other monoamine receptors, not to say that they wouldn't ultimately become involved. Accordingly, we can mimic the EE resistance to A-beta oligomers by prolonged feeding of a beta adrenergic agonist, isoproterenol. We've now done it with procaterol, which is more specific, to the standard housing mice. Now, let's summarize by reminding you that there are an awful lot of elements of the Alzheimer riddle that I haven't had time to speak about. But in general terms, people like myself who draw these kinds of linear cascades believe that you can enter the Alzheimer process by two general routes. You can have dominantly inherited mutations in APP, presenilin 1 or presenilin 2, which are the principal autosomal dominant deterministic mutations, and that can lead to increased A-beta 42 accumulation and its oligomerization throughout life. And that's not so much a speculation. We have good evidence that that happens to those few but unfortunate individuals who have those rare familial mutations. You and I would develop Alzheimer's much more likely through the right side, where a variety of complex genetic and environmental alterations would, in my view of the world, change the clearance of A-beta, or maybe accentuate its production in some special ways, and that would also lead to too much A-beta 42 lifelong and the chance for oligomerization. And then after that, the two pathogenic schema would be united. That is, you would have a rather similar cascade of events. Sure, there are differences, but at this level of approximation, I think if we can interrupt either the entry on the right or the entry on the left, which is what people are trying to do now, some of the downstream consequences that we frankly don't understand well and that are a bit of a black box, including inflammatory mechanisms, microglial activation, calcium dishomeostasis, we could perhaps avoid those. Now, one of the Achilles heels of this hypothesis has been the concept that beta amyloid deposits occur in entirely healthy, normal people, and they can die and have a brain full of amyloid. But it's important to say that mostly those deposits are the diffuse type of plaques that we've known out about for about 25 years or so, and that largely lack fibrillar amyloid, microglia, dystrophic neurites, and many of the more mature phenomena. There are some mature plaques in healthy folks, but by and large they tilt towards less neuritic glial pathology. The soluble oligomeric levels in such subjects have generally not been quantified finally. So the way we can now do it with oligomeric beta-sensitive ELISAs need to be applied to people who died with normal mentation, have amyloid in their brain, what were their oligomer levels. The absence of subtle memory deficits before death and not confirmed are not really confirmed. So, for example, PET-positive A-beta deposits seen in normal elderly are often associated with subtle cognitive changes, as I'll show you in a moment. And all chronic diseases, like cancer and coronary disease, have histopathology prior to the earliest symptoms. So here's some work from a group that I'm not at all affiliated with, in which during the normal aging lifespan process, amyloid plaques were quantified by Pittsburgh Compound B imaging, or AVID-45 actually in this case. And you can see that all these individuals who were felt to be cognitively normal in this particular study have a steady rise in the amount of plaques. The folks in red were also cognitively normal, but they had a particularly high level of the signal for Pittsburgh Compound B, or for AVID-45 in this case. And those subjects, as well as the other subjects, were examined by various psychometric tests. And you can see here that those ones that were in red on the last slide had a correlation coefficient that was significant between the burden of Pittsburgh of AVID-45 positive plaques and their scores on several aspects of working memory, etc., but not so much immediate recall or typical episodic memory, because they didn't have Alzheimer's. They didn't have frank Alzheimer's symptoms. This group and many others believes that the accrual of these A-beta deposits when you don't have Alzheimer's nonetheless is giving you stress to your hippocampal and limbic and cortical networks and causing trouble. Now, many people ask me, how do we put together the different amyloidogenic components of the cascade? And I think that monomers on the left are largely not bioactive as far as pathology goes, as pathogenesis. They have other biological properties. Oligomers of various sorts, like I've tried to tell you today, are bioactive. And then as you get into fibrils and plaques of various sorts, they have less bioactivity. So if you do a solubility curve, just a biochemical solubility curve, then the most soluble are the early assemblies. If you look at synaptotoxicity, it is those early assemblies that seem to be particularly associated with cytopathology and neuritic problems. I imagine that the capacity for amyloid cores to sequester additional soluble A-beta oligomers when I'm 65, 70, 75 becomes limited, saturated, so that new A-beta oligomers that arise from the natural production of the peptide throughout life do not find a relatively temporarily protective site in the amyloid plaque cores. So is amyloid a cause or an effect of Alzheimer's disease? Well, almost certainly it's going to turn out to be both. We know in other systemic amyloid diseases, they can be both cause and effect. In primary transthyretin amyloidosis, the transthyretin is mutant, and you get a terrible peripheral neuropathy that's fatal. When the transthyretin is wild type, it can build up in older hearts and cause so-called senile cardiac amyloidosis. Similarly, A-beta accumulation is a primary cause, I believe, in patients with APP at least, and probably also presenilin mutations. But in late-onset Alzheimer's disease, it occurs secondary to other causes, of which there are a host that we haven't discovered. And aging, which I really mean not so much aging as when you get gray hair and get wrinkles, but time on the planet. You could be old enough at age 35 or 40 if you had a genetic predisposition to Alzheimer's, but you won't get the Alzheimer's syndrome at 15 or 18, except for that one rare woman that I mentioned. So time on the planet seems to overcome an energetic barrier to let this biochemical polymerization process go forward because it has many other controlling elements, chaperones, etc. So finally, what are we doing about it in the clinic? And I put up the data from Eli Lilly that I obviously had nothing to do with at all, that they put on their website. The important point about these two trials called Expedition 1 and Expedition 2 is that Lilly gave their data to the ADCS, an academic consortium, to independently analyze what was found in these 18-month trials in a lot of folks with Alzheimer's disease, about, I think, 2,200 or so altogether. And what both the ADCS and Lilly concluded was that the overall trials were unsuccessful. They did not meet their endpoints, so they were not FDA fileable. But if you looked at mild patients, as Lilly had pre-specified it would do at the end of the trial, you began to see a splaying of the curves between the antibody that Lilly gave, that is in red here, solanezumab, and placebo injections once a month. And around 24 to 28 weeks, there was a splaying of the curves in their first trial. In the second trial, there was a separation, but it was largely parallel. When they combined the two trials, and they had about 1,100 patients, they got a statistically significant, p less than 0.01, 35% decrease in the rate of cognitive slowing or decline. There was still decline, but it was not as robust. Very importantly, when Lilly and the ADCS analyzed the moderate patients of the same trial, we had a controlled experiment. The placebo and the antibody treatments overlapped. So once you got to a moderate stage, the same treatment given in the same trial in a double-blinded, triple-blinded fashion didn't do any good. And the p-values on the far right tell you what they came up with in this trial that could not really qualify for FDA approval. I wish it had. I wish we could be infusing this now because I think the agent has some biological activity. But Lilly, of course, is doing another trial, and very importantly, my colleague Risa Sperling and her colleagues here at Columbia and around the country, especially Paul Azen at the ADCS and UCSD, have organized the so-called A4 trial, anti-amyloid in asymptomatic Alzheimer's for people like me who might still be able to give a lecture like this but might have the buildup of amyloid beta in our brain shown by PET scan. So I could volunteer for the trial. Risa will do a PET scan on me. If I have amyloid buildup or if I have other biomarkers like spinal fluid abnormalities, I could enter that trial and over the next 5 years be given Lilly's antibody. Lilly is contributing their antibody to this academically organized trial. So Alzheimerology in 2020, I like to think, will involve risk assessment at age 50. So we were going to look at closely at the history, especially the family history, which is enormously important, and the neurological exam, as we always do in the clinic. We'll do brief cognitive screens initially, and then followed by a full-fledged psychometric testing. We may do gene screens, very likely will, an AD risk chip, which has been envisioned by geneticists, to try to determine alleles that are associated with a higher risk of the disease. We will image, by A-beta scanning, by tau scanning. When I made this slide, there wasn't such a thing as tau scanning, but it's now arrived, principally through the work at the company Siemens, but others also, and then fMRI imaging, which is already very important as one correlate. We may do blood A-beta antibody challenge tests to give someone an antibody, see what happens to their sudden rise in A-beta in their plasma. More importantly, CSF assays are enormously important, and that will give us a numerical AD risk score. So the last slide is what we're going to do with that information. Based on your risk category into which a person falls, we'll consider pre-symptomatic subjects with negative A-beta scans. We'll be offered the possibility of a beta or gamma secretase inhibitor if they're available in 2020 or thereafter. And maybe an A-beta oligomer inhibitor that keeps the oligomers from building up or forming. Presymptomatic subjects with a positive A-beta scan who already have evidence of amyloidosis will again be offered beta or gamma secretase inhibitors or modulators or the aforementioned oligomer inhibitor, but they'll also be offered something that might work on their existing deposits, such as A-beta immunotherapy, active vaccination with A-beta fragments, or passive antibody infusion. And then symptomatic subjects who already are positive in terms of the amyloid pathology, a secretase inhibitor plus A-beta immunotherapy, and of course a variety of symptomatic agents that we use now and that are also being tested in clinical trials. So thank you very much for your attention. These are the folks that I mentioned on the slides.
Equivalent exercise wheels and plastic tubes for the Harvard faculty to run around in. Is that part of the recruiting?
Well, first I'd like to thank my friend Dennis for coming down from Boston. Dennis, I'll show you my office in a few minutes. It's got a few of those toys in there now. I'm taking your lead on that. I just want to put... Okay, so I just want to make a couple of points for the audience, and that is that Dennis and I trained at about the same time, but first in internal medicine, and then we went into our fields of neurology. And at the time when we were both new neurologists, Alzheimer's disease was sort of a disorder where people were confused, they were on the back wards, they filled beds, and we really had very little understanding of what was going on. And I remember very vividly my first grant was returned with a comment. There were other problems with it, but one of the comments was, how do you tell Alzheimer's disease from just normal aging? So we've come a long way. And to just put this in a perspective that you might not appreciate, it's largely because of Dennis's work that all of the genetics that's going on has a target now. If you compare this to something, say, like schizophrenia, where there's no abnormal protein yet that we've identified, I mean, there's some speculation, but this is a clear target. There's actually a couple of targets now that we can work on. So this has given us a target whenever we find a gene to try to see whether it fits into this paradigm. And this also led, that discovery also led to being able to identify a biological, a biomarker, such as using brain imaging, amyloid PET, and then CSF analysis of A beta and tau. So it's much more profound. Dennis did a wonderful job of telling us the biology of the disease, but he doesn't understand that he was probably the original geneticist and the original neuroimager, or at least inspired us to use that target from his work. So having said all that, Dennis, I want to put you on the spot now. And I have a couple of questions. Do we know anything about the normal function of A-beta and its precursor, the amyloid precursor protein? So it would be really interesting to know what's the normal function? Because they are produced, as you say, in everybody, in all of us. So what's its normal function? A second thought is, and I think you were starting to say that, but you didn't really come out and say it. And I know you and I have had this conversation, so I want to... You and I both think that we're giving these anti-A-beta therapies way too late. And we should start it at the first signal, so I'd like you to comment on that. And then the last thing is, what is the cause of neuronal loss in the disease? You almost said that A-beta, the synaptic loss, may be what eventually kills the neuron, but that would be something to address. And then comment on the seeding, which is another extraordinary thing we've seen both in New York and in Boston.
I don't know if you can hear me all right without the microphone. Can you hear me in the back? Yes? Okay, so I'm an Irish whisper. So I think the normal function of the amyloid precursor protein and A-beta are under intensive study. Some of the very nice work on A-beta's function has been done by Octavio Runcio and colleagues here in the Department of Pathology, I believe, at Columbia. And the idea is that the amyloid beta peptide as a monomer might, if anything, have salutary effects on synaptic plasticity, on regulating synaptic plasticity. So it's an irony that when it pairs up with another monomer and makes a dimer and higher, that it causes a lot of trouble. So I think that it has subtle synaptic effects in the brain. We say the brain because beta secretase is an enzyme that's mostly expressed in the brain. And so that's where a lot of the body's A-beta is manufactured. But, of course, it is present in muscle and throughout the body. But we don't really know for sure exactly how A-beta does its good work, that it's a normal peptide. And it's still a possibility that this cutting of ATP by beta and gamma secretase that I define is just a normal metabolism that produces the other parts of the APP molecule that do good things after the cutting, and the little piece of string that's in the middle doesn't really, hasn't acquired a real function in evolution. We don't know for sure that it's important. But if you do experiments in the lab, you can show almost anything has some biological activity. I don't think we're ever going to have to worry about the normal function of amyloid beta protein when we treat with anti-amyloid therapies, because we'll very unlikely ever reduce it to the levels that you guys have in your brains right now, which are, let's say, under 40, right, which are very low levels, relatively speaking. Now, APP is another important molecule, and in short, it is a type of a signaling receptor. It has ligands that bind to its ectodomain. There's no one discrete classical ligand like NGF binds to an NGF receptor. It's not as simple as that. But we and others have published a number of potential ligands that are normal products of metabolism and genes that signal. And APP is a signaling molecule. We don't know what its cytoplasmic domain signals, and it doesn't do the same thing that Notch does. It's very clear from Bart Stroop's work and other work that we haven't figured out exactly how it signals, but it obviously has a normal function. The interesting thing about APP, quickly, is that there are two homologs, APLP1, APLP2, and they are probably more important in biology. So, and we don't know why their little piece in the middle doesn't contribute to a chronic disease of humans. Maybe it does, and we haven't figured that out. But APLP1, APLP2, they're cut up just like APP is, and they probably are more functionally important. So you ask the next question about mild Alzheimer's disease and going earlier. And absolutely, you and I 100% agree, as almost everyone in the field, that we need to treat this disease by preventing it, which is the theme of Jerry's seminar series. And that is being done, I think, by trials in familial Alzheimer's disease, by which we mean people with presenilin or APP mutations. They're being treated now. There's family in Colombia that has a presenilin mutation, E280A, that is the world's largest family with Alzheimer's, one genetic pedigree, probably from a single founder effect, I believe. And so that's happening with an antibody from Genentech, and then another group, the DIAN study that many people, Richard and others, are part of and contribute to, is doing a study, mostly in the United States, with presenilin and APP families to try to treat with more than one different therapeutic and see what works. And then I am most excited about, because I'm parochial and I'm from Boston, I'm a local fireman, about the trial that I think Risa Sperling gets a lot of credit for having driven forward and initiated, the A4 trial that I mentioned, anti-amyloid and asymptomatic Alzheimer's, that will be done here. I have a brother-in-law who I hope will get into that trial, and Larry is seeing him, and we're hoping, we're keeping our fingers crossed. He's too good right now, but being too good on your mental status means you could get into the A4 trial, because you have to have a clean cognitive assessment but have amyloid in your brain to do what we call secondary prevention, to try to keep the buildup. So I think that's very, very important. And then the other point was what, the neural consequence? Or
well, the cell neuronal death? Loss.
I'm glad that he looked at his crib sheet on his cell phone.
I can't remember all this.
I would need it. So the neuronal loss of Alzheimer's is a very interesting topic, and that is that this is a neurodegenerative disease, and we think that, you know, the neuron has to give up the ghost and die. But more and more over the years, I've come to the belief that that's not really the heart of the matter. That, yes, neurons die, and I think the answer to Richard's question is that they die from 1,000 blows, that from synaptic compromise, from synaptic pruning, from less dendritic arbor, from microglial activation, the release of a lot of different gene products from microglia and the astrocytes, that short circuits the life of the nerve cell. And eventually the entire neuron dies, and if you count neurons, you can see less neurons in certain areas of the hippocampus or amygdala or cortex than you do in an age-matched control. But that's obviously far too late. Now, neurons die before you have your first symptoms of Alzheimer's. There's little doubt about that, because this process evolves over 20 to 30 years before you forget where you parked your car. But the neuronal death is a late event in any one neuron's life. And before that, I think there's an attack, especially on synapses. And that's the part that we have to mitigate or try to rescue, in my opinion.
Just comment on the seeding issue.
So one of the big theories in the neurodegenerative field has been the concept of a prion-like process where one cell can have the aggregation of a particular protein, let's say tau protein, making up tangles, and then that can be released in small amounts and being taken up by the next neuron in the pathway and act as a seed to get the normal tau protein in the next neuron to do a bad thing. So a bad seed is the best way to put it. And this is a hypothesis that has caught on fire around the globe in our field. And perhaps, much to Richard's chagrin, I'll tell you that I have actually some second thoughts about the pathogenic relevance of that theory. There is absolutely no doubt that in mouse models and in cell culture, you can do what I do in my lab and damage cells, damage neurons by applying A beta and then allowing the endogenous protein that contacts that A beta or that tau protein. It's a little tougher with tau because tau is intracellular, A beta is principally extracellular. You can seed the process. And a lot of this idea comes from the work of Heiko Brock, who I've debated this with, who has said that there's sort of a hierarchy or progression of the involvement of different neurons in the human nervous system. The same, he has said, is true of Parkinson's disease. But I tell him that it's difficult to say that if you collect a brain at age 6 years and you see some tau abnormality in the entorhinal cortex, then you collect a brain from an obviously different human being at age 16 years and you see some more tau in one area and then another area, and you collect a brain at 40 and 70 and 90, that you can string those together in an orderly pathogenic sequence. It could be that that represents what we call selective vulnerability. The concept that certain neurons have the abnormality intrinsically before other neurons get it. Just like with almost every other human chronic disease, there is a selectivity. So we're debating in the field whether this is the old concept of selective neuronal vulnerability, and any cell that has excess tau, and all neurons have a lot of tau, could give up the ghost in a cell autonomous fashion. Or is it principally non-autonomous, as the spreading hypothesis would have it. So, Richard, I had a chance to have lunch with Michelle Goddard in Cambridge, England, recently, who's been a fantastic biologist working on tau, synuclein, et cetera, with his team. And I asked him, if you imagine a person with a tau mutation that has a problem with tau from in utero days on, do you think that that person develops their problem by spreading the tau aggregates? And he said, you know, in that case, I'm very skeptical of that. I think that they have enough abnormal tau in any one neuron that the neuron can autonomously self-destruct or cause the process. So I said, well, then if you believe in the spreading hypothesis, you're thinking of two different mechanisms. One that involves genetic mutations in the target protein itself, like synuclein, and the other that involves idiopathic disease where other factors cause the spread. I prefer to lump and split.
Let's see if we can get a student or two. Questions for either of these two gentlemen?
I have a question, but I'm going to school in a while.
You're a professional student.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Very enlightening presentation. From what you showed us today, there's several things that we know. One is that there is a great deal known about the neurobiology, what is taking place in the brain in terms of the beta amyloid and tau and so on. Two, you have indicated that the therapeutic approaches of today don't seem to change the progression of the disease. But the good thing that you have said is that it appears that environmental enrichment, and in fact, I do environmental enrichment, so this is why I'm interested, seems to mitigate some of the effects. So the question that I have from a public health perspective is, why do we place so much emphasis in trying to develop therapeutics, and we don't place as much emphasis trying to catch the individual early in time, let's say 30s and 40s, and provide the idea that if you exercise more, that if you read more, and actually I tell my students that when I lecture, which is a way to enrich your brain, that could potentially could push the incidence of dementias to even later ages. And there doesn't seem to be a great deal of emphasis from a public health perspective in doing that.
Yeah, novel environments as well.
Yeah. So I think the answer to the question is because there are too many of me and too few of you. There are folks who build their careers on the wonders of genetic engineering and modern biotechnology, and we do a lot of experiments, and they catch the public attention, they catch the public dollar. I think that's all for the good, because I think that there is a remarkable biological imperative to the thing we call Alzheimer's. It really wants to keep on going and hurt you. But because we haven't invested as much in behavioral approaches, environmental novelty, et cetera, the folks who do pharmacology, biochemistry, molecular biology seem to dominate the airwaves, so to speak. But I'm here to tell you that I've seen the light, and I am very interested in getting my mice to be smarter. And since I can only work with mice and not humans, I'm encouraging people like yourself and your colleagues to beat the drum for protection or various environmental factors. And obviously, what we were doing was just following the behaviorists and saying, we can try to do reductionist biology on what is this really doing in the brain, and most importantly, what is it doing to protect from oligomeric A beta, which is one of my fixations. So I think the answer is yes, we want to do that. And I'm writing a grant right now, literally, I'm sending mine in tomorrow. And it is about environmental enrichment. And it's saying the biologist may not deliver a therapy for us for another 10, 20 years. And we need to do something right now to stave off this disease. I really believe that those of us, essentially everyone in this room, who have a rich cognitive life, who have pretty good health, who avoid smoking and beating their heads up, and live well, they are going to get less than their fair share of Alzheimer's disease, which is good. And so I do believe that behavioral modification is a very smart way to go, and there's plenty of evidence in the literature that it can make you less likely to get trouble.
Jay?
Yes. Okay. I'll take the from the stroke division. I have a question. You briefly mentioned the beta-2 adrenergic receptor. What is the main in vivo agonist for that receptor? And second, related to the same receptor, do you think that exercising, for example, we tend to believe that it improves cardiovascular health, but do you think that washing yourself in catecholamines, exercising, actually leads to the stimulation of this receptor?
Yeah. That's a great, so it's norepinephrine, so the classical norepinephrine would be the principal endogenous neurotransmitter that activates the adrenergic receptors. But we can use drugs that mimic that very closely and are safe, like propranolol, which we've done now, and that has a lot of benefits, and we fed our mice living in those boring cages, and they have some of the benefits. Now, you know, neurobiology is very complicated, and I obviously am risking oversimplifying the story to say that the beta-2 adrenergic receptor pathway is the principal pathway. But it is one, and we did a timed experiment where we applied soluble oligomers from our patients' brains to cultured healthy hippocampal neurons and looked to see which neurotransmitter receptors were impacted early. Their phosphorylation status changed. Their endocytosis of the plasma membrane was altered. And beta-2 adrenergic receptors stood out. So there has to be some molecular specificity in biochemistry that can happen. And then lots of other things happen later on. So maybe exercise is boosting adrenaline in the body as a whole, and maybe that has some benefit. And so I very much agree that exercise is a very good idea. And I actually hadn't thought so much about whether exercise is likely doing that. We need to do some pharmacology and measure norepinephrine and other neurotransmitters during exercise, which we can do by microdialysis, so we can have living, behaving mice with a tube in their brain, and we can collect these. So that you've given me a very good idea, which I will take all the credit for.
So I'm afraid our time is up. Please join me in thanking you two, Marvin.
Thank you.